Good morning and welcome to Mountain View Baptist Church. Good to have you here on June the 14th of 2020. And good to have everyone here. Let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Father, we thank you for your goodness to us. We thank you for the privilege that we have to be gathered as a church family here at Mountain View Baptist Church. We pray for those that aren't able to be here with us today, that they will know that they are missed. And Lord, that you'll be able to work in their hearts also. And Father, we pray that you would draw near unto us as we draw nigh unto you. And Father, that you do things great in our hearts here today. Help us to live for you. Help us to see what a great future we have that you have in store for us in heaven. Thank you, Lord, that you have paid for all of our sins, and by our belief in you, we can have our sins forgiven and have a home in heaven for forever. Thank you, Lord, for loving us. It's in Christ Jesus' name that we pray and ask these things. Amen. If you got your songbook with you, find number 457. Number 457. We'll just have you remain seated here on this song, 457. And Robert's going to come and lead us.
To God be the glory, great things he hath done. 457, sing it out.
To God be the glory.
Solid rock.
Satan's wages, I'm standing on the solid rock. Even though he's gone now, I don't feel alone now. With comfort came the Spirit.
Some here that haven't been for a while. Good to have Curtis back Amen. With us here. It's been like 3 months since Curtis has been to church. But good to have Curtis here with us. Good to have the music here with us. And we've got Trudy back in Missouri with her mom. Her mom had successful surgery on Wednesday. Recovering, should be home this week. And then Trudy will be coming back home the end of the week. And then Noah is back in the States. And so he'll be taking some leave here sometime, and maybe we'll get to see him through the summer. Dean, if you will get these out, if you weren't here on Thursday night, we've got our prayer sheet for our missionaries, the Baldovinos and Mrs. Jackson. And so you pray for them specifically each day through this week. And then you also have the other missionaries listed here, and so that you have a list of all of them. And we'll give you some more announcements here. If you need one of those, wasn't here on Thursday night, raise your hand, and Dean will get one handed out to you. Tomorrow, something is exciting happening right here at Mountain View Baptist Church. We're having youth conference.
Yeah.
And so that will be starting at 9 a.m. in the morning and run until 7 p.m. Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday night. Teenagers will be hanging around here all day. And so pray for our teenagers. Pray for decisions. You're like, well, Pastor, it won't be the same. I think it'll be better because we're even having some of the teenagers that wouldn't be able to go to Santa Clara for 3 days. They're going to be able to be here for a day or two, and that might be the day that they get some things settled, get some things right. So we're looking forward to that. So pray for our teenagers throughout this week. At home, you can watch it online. All the services will be there just like normal. NVBC TV or .com or whatever it is, .org, I think is what they've got, but North Valley's website, you can watch all of those. On Thursday night, we're going to be letting you know what takes place next Sunday. Next Sunday will be our Mother's and Father's Day Sunday. So we're just going to group them there. Ladies, don't want you all to feel left out. We're equal opportunity celebrators of Mother's Day. And so we'll have Mother's Day and Father's Day next week. And I will have a small door prize for you or something if you come, amen? And but then also next week is when we have been meeting and doing the social distance and doing all the things that the CDC and the county and the state all want us to do. And so it's coming up to where it would be the 21 days. And if there's not been a breakout and things like that, we're going to really open it up to where visitors, we've had people call and want to come to church. And so we'll be letting them know that we'd have visitors here. We're not at capacity today, but right at it. And so next week then, we'll let you know on Thursday night, when you bring your kids in here, we're going to let the kids come up the hallway over here at that door, and then my wife and son will be taking care of junior church, and they'll be back here in the back, and then we'll have the adults. and other visitors in here. But we'll let you know on Thursday night how that's all working out. And that'll be good. Let's see what else we got going on. That's all the announcements. Boy, they're just quick this week. And we're going to take a special. And so if someone would like to sing, you want us to sing one of your favorite songs, whoever raises your hand first, after I ask for you to, but we'll let Emilio go first there, and then maybe take one more, Robert.
Yes, sir. All right, Mr. Emilio, what's your favorite song today?
Tell It to Jesus.
Tell It to Jesus, 114 in your hymnals. I believe 114, are you weary? Are you heavy hearted? We'll remain seated for this song. Sing it out together.
Are you weary? Are you heavy hearted? Tell it to Jesus. Tell it to Jesus. Are you grieving over joys departed? Tell
song this morning, Miss Elena. 258? 258. Let's see if we know it. 258. Oh, how I love Jesus. There is a name I love to hear. 258 in your hymnals. Let's sing it out together on the first verse. There is a name.
Oh, God.
number 241, 241, Grace Greater Than Our Sin. Once you find your place, let's stand and sing out this morning. Marvelous grace of our loving Lord, sing it out.
Marvelous grace of
find in your Bibles. 1 Peter in chapter 4. 1 Peter in chapter 4. And we're just going to look at a few verses there, read these together in 1 Peter. And then we're going to go back to the start of the book of 1 Peter and go through some things. And if you're like me, as you've been watching the news just in the last few days, in the last few weeks, and as COVID-19 hit and kind of changed the world, as we had been living in it. Now it just seems like, well, what else is going to happen? What else is going to happen? And there's a lot that's going to be happening. And a lot of times we may get discouraged or we may get distraught because, well, you know, what's God doing? Why is he allowing these things to happen? And when you get to that point to where you start to blame God or why God's doing this, why is he allowing this to happen? You need to go back and read scripture because God, and I'll say it this way, God didn't promise us a rose garden here on earth right. In this life.
Right.
And as we look through the book of 1 Peter here, you're going to see some words that are going to show up and some phrases that are going to show up in multiple places. And you see that there's something that Christians are called upon to go through and Christians are going to have to deal with. And the paradise, if you want to say it that way, or where everything is fixed and all tears are wiped away, that's in the future. That's in the future. Right now we're living in the present. But you're not going to have your present life. You're not going to be living it, we'll say it this way, in the right way if you don't look back at the past and see what God has done in the past. So if you're going to have a right relationship with God, you're going to be living it the right way. You've got to accept the past. And you've got to be allowing him and your belief in him to permeate, if you will, your belief. And because you have the past right and you've accepted the past and you're living your present right, then the future is bright for you. Okay? So hopefully that's going to help you. But anytime, and you're going to hear me say this, we're not going to finish this morning. We'll finish it more tonight, maybe even in the Thursday night. Could be one of those series that will go for a while. And I know I have taught. I have, man, when a camera's on you, you just say some dumb things. And there's no way to edit those things out. Well, I guess there is if you knew how. I know I have taught through 1 Peter and have preached through 1 Peter some very familiar passages of Scripture from the book of 1 and 2 Peter. And you need to realize, well, who wrote 1 Peter? And a lot of times, see, when you're studying the Bible, you're trying to figure out, you know, what's the writer saying to me? We know the author is God. And then you have the human writer that's written it down. Holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. And it's like, well, why is he writing that? What's important about him? And what was one of the last things that Jesus personally told Peter? Told him how he was going to end his life. And so Peter has that. How would you like to be walking with that on your shoulders, knowing that you're going to be crucified? And not because you want to be, but because you're serving God and that's how it's happening. And see, and that's foreign to our world today and really Christianity today. And it's the one reason that our Christian voice has been quieted and the one reason that our country and the world is in the shape that it's in. God's coming back and God's warning everybody and God has to do something when people stop believing in him according to his word. See, and in the past, he's given us his word, and so we're supposed to let his word influence our present so that we can have the future that God wants us to have. God's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Jesus Christ died on the cross to pay for the sins of the whole world. He doesn't want anybody to go to hell. But only those that believe in him and trust in him in this present life are going to be the ones that enter in to the rest, if you will, or to heaven. Those that reject him, those that don't believe in him, they've had opportunity, but they are going to be separated from God forever in a place called hell. But see, we maybe understand that, have those things there, but then we get all worked up in our lives and it's like, what else is going to happen in America? It's going to get worse. It's going to get worse. I think the next thing that you're going to see sometime through the summer is probably where maybe not full-scale war breaks out, but you're going to see some acts of war. You're going to see the sabers are rattling. And they've always had sabers rattling and things like that, but we've never seen the world to where it is today and the situation that's taken place and the mindset of some people that have sabers to rattle. And it's not America that's rattling the saber. A lot of people trying to throw all this stuff back on America. No, America's always been the peacekeeper. And America has gone and bailed out Europe twice because Europe had messed up thinking and they didn't solve their problems themselves. And so American men and women had to go and give their lives. And ever since then, everybody's looked at America to fix their problems. And now they don't like it when America tries to fix their problems. Well, why don't you start fixing your problems yourself? And then somebody else won't have to do it. And it comes back even to the same scale as in the church. You know, people always say, "Well, preacher, you stepped on my toes." Well, if you'd had your toes in the right place and had them pointed in the right direction, doing the right thing, you wouldn't needed them to be stepped on.
Right.
It comes back to personal responsibility. If you respect yourself, you'll live in a respectful way.
Amen.
A lot of people want respect in our nation today, but they're not living a respectable life.
Right.
You can think about that and dwell on that and apply that to whoever you want to, but if the slipper fits, you're the princess. Sorry. And I never thought that our country and how fast it has gone down, how fast things are happening. So, let's stand together. 1 Peter in chapter 4. 1 Peter in chapter 4. And we'll begin reading in verse 16. So follow along with me. 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 16. "Yet if any man suffer as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God on this behalf. For the time has come that judgment must begin at the house of God. And if it first begin at us, what shall the end be of them that obey not the gospel of God? And if the righteous scarcely be saved, where shall the ungodly and the sinner appear? Wherefore, let them that suffer according to us," we thank you for the privilege that we have your word opened up to us today. We pray that you would guide us and lead us. Lord, that you would open the eyes of our understanding. Lord, that your words would be powerful here today. That, Lord, that you would take away the blindness that is maybe even upon our hearts and our minds, that the God of this world is placed there. And Lord, that your light would so shine into our hearts that we would see what you have done for us and how great a salvation that you have given us. And Father, that you would meet with us in a special way and encourage us as we see the world changing so rapidly around us, and not in a good way, but Lord, going back into anarchy and violence. Lord, help us to be able to be the light that shines and the salt of the earth, that those around us would see that we have a hope in Christ Jesus, and that hope is settled and secure, and it'll not change. Now, Father, I pray and ask that you fill me with your Holy Spirit and use me here today. Help me to say everything I should and to not say things that I shouldn't. It's in our Savior's name, the Lord Jesus Christ, that we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Robert, did the camera turn off there? You got it back on? All right. So when you hear a little beep like that, if somebody up front hears that, we'll check the camera there. They won't see you walking around back there as you go and check that, so that'll be all right. All right, so what do we see here in verse 16? We see, "Yet if any man suffer as a Christian," suffering as a Christian, oh, that's not mainstream Christianity today. That's not the thought that's there. Man, everything in Christianity today is name it and claim it. God's going to take care of all your problems. You're not going to suffer. You're not going to have, if you get a headache, oh, Jesus, take the headache away from me. And he's just supposed to come down and, no, that's what aspirin's for. And so everybody's expecting God to fix their problems and make everything perfect. And it's amazing how we see that and we've been lulled into that, even in this very room, the way this room is set up, and I'll get back to that in a little bit. We've been to where God's going to take care of everything for us, and we're failing to understand and see what's been written in the past, how that needs to affect us here today. You've heard me make the statement, Christianity that is authentic must be able to be replicated in any kind of environment. So if what you say is Christianity, but it relies on electricity, or it relies on everything being perfect, that's not authentic Christianity. If you're like, well, we didn't have electricity, so we didn't have air conditioning, and we didn't have the band, and we didn't have the amplifiers, and we didn't have YouTube. Oh, that's not authentic Christianity. Authentic Christianity is where somebody opens up the Word of God, stands on a stump, and preaches the Word of God. You're like, well, we just didn't have all the singing that we could have. No, we haven't had all the singing that we could have, but I certainly enjoyed the singing that we had today. Because it was people that know God, love God, want to worship God, come together and sing together.
Good.
Even if we didn't have piano, and I'm glad that we do, but we can still worship God. That's authentic. Okay, you're like, well, Pastor, you got air conditioner on, you got lights on. Oh, okay, I understand that. I'm not saying that we can't have conveniences, but just think of this room. If there were no electricity, there would be no lights, and there would be no air conditioning. Now, how would we cool this room off? How would we let light in? Do you notice the windows that are here? You can't open them up, and they do not let light in. But I remember the church building that we met in down in Ceres that had no air conditioning, only had a swamp cooler. It had large windows on the sides in an auditorium. It had twice the windows as what this room has. And it's half the size of it, but you could open the windows and you could let the light in. Why? Because it was designed for a time before air conditioning and before electricity. That'd be an authentic building. You're like, well, what about all the great church buildings that they have? They're all conveniences. Yeah. But if you're basing your Christianity on having fancy things and nice things that are convenient, your Christianity is not much. See, we've gotten away from this thought of suffering. Yeah. As you read through 1 Peter, and I encourage you to read through it and study it yourself, you're going to see that word suffering come up in a lot of ways. Christ suffered. And we're supposed to suffer as Christians. Hey, and suffering for Christians is not sitting through a long preaching service.
Right.
It's not sitting through a boring preaching service. No, it's not suffering. Okay? Oh, having to give an offering. No, that's not suffering. That's not suffering. You didn't have to wrestle the animal down and drag them and lead them here to the temple and then slaughter them to bring them in. You're just able to put your tithe in a bucket there in the back. Come on, we got it pretty easy here in 2020 and how we get to bring an offering to God. You didn't have to go out and catch a bird. Come on.
Amen.
You just had to bring some of your dough. And that's Bible. Okay? Now, go back with me. Let's look here in 1 Peter chapter 1. And we'll start in chapter 1 here. But how do we reconcile our current situation that we're going through with COVID-19 and violence all around the country and all these things? You know, it's just part of life. And if we're suffering because of it, okay, that's all right. We just suffer through this because we know that when we are called home by the rapture or we're called home by death to be absent from the bodies, to be present with the Lord. I have that hope.
Yeah.
And hope is not a wish. Hope is a certainty that's not yet seen yet. And that's what hope I have. And so I base my hope on what happened in the past. Remember, past, present, and future. And as you read through the book of 1 Peter, and we're going to do that here to help you understand some things, you need to be looking for past, present, and future. Okay? Let's start in, look at verse 3. Chapter 1 and verse 3. It says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." So, the resurrection of Christ was past. That's what we're basing our faith upon. But then we're born again or begotten again. Man, that's present. And because I was born again, now I live a different life. Let's look in verse 4. "To an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you." Wait a minute, reserved in heaven for you. That's future. So we've got past, present, and future. And you're going to see those things work back and forth there. And it helps you to understand what we're going through. Look in verse 5. "Who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation." Man, when were we kept? Right now. And God settled it in the past, but right now that we're living in it, and look what it does, ready to be revealed in the last time. When's the last time? That's future, right? So we're seeing that in one verse, past, present, and future. Verse 6, "Wherein ye greatly rejoice, though now for a season, if need be, ye are in heaviness through manifold temptations, that the trial of your faith, being much more precious than of gold that perisheth, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ. When's Jesus Christ going to appear? Hasn't happened yet. It's in the future. When's the trial of your faith? Right now. Right now. Your faith is being tried. You're like, oh no, I placed my faith in Jesus and it's done. Exactly, for salvation. But now what you say you believe is what you're supposed to be living. Faith without works is what? Dead. And you got a lot of people say they know Jesus, but no works in their life. They don't have anything in their life that would demonstrate their faith in God. Look at verse 8. Whom having not seen, ye love. I've not seen him, but I love him. In whom, though now ye see him not, yet believing ye rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory. Man, when we sing, how about that hymn, Mansion Over a Hilltop?
Yep.
That's not really for right now. That's for in the future. Yeah, he's gone to prepare a place for us.
Amen.
John chapter 14. Right?
Yep.
And because he's gone to prepare a place for us, we love him and we're going to live for him. We're going to live a different life. So the past affects our present and that affects our future. I'll just tell you now, this week I'm going to buy a different camera. Take four.
Amen.
Whichever it is, I apologize to the online crowd if it's choppy there. Robert's doing it all. He's to blame.
Amen.
And but listen for that little beep if it goes off. See, time it. See if it's like every 11 minutes or something. I don't understand that. We got plenty of power. All right. So let's keep going here. We're in verse number 8. Whom having not seen ye love, in whom, though now ye see him not, yet believing, ye rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory, receiving the end of your faith, even the salvation of your souls, of which salvation the prophets have inquired and searched diligently, who prophesied of the grace that should come unto you. Wait a minute, you had prophets in the past that wanted to find out about this thing. They inquired about this salvation. Where'd they hear about salvation? Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. First time that the gospel is preached. And so you have the prophets. If you want to say Isaiah, it's like, when's that happening? When's that happening? And he inquired about it. See, he went down to the library, got the books out and studied. He might have went to a library and went and studied, but how did he inquire? Lord, when's that happening? Will you give me wisdom? Daniel says that he was in prayer, and that's when God gave him wisdom and understanding about things. That's how he come to know that the 70 years that Jeremiah talked about. Okay? By prayer. So you had prophets in the past that sought diligently and inquired about these things that were coming up in their future. They're in our present right now. Let's keep going. Verse 11. Here's what they did. Searching what or what manner of time the Spirit of Christ, which was in them, did signify when it testified beforehand the sufferings of Christ and the glory that should follow. We meant the sufferings of Christ. When would they have heard about that? How about Isaiah chapter 53? How about Psalm 22? Right? Are you following me now? And see, what they give us in the past, we now have affects us in the future.
Right.
In verse 12, it says, unto whom it was revealed that not unto themselves, but unto us, they did minister the things which are now reported unto you by them that have preached the gospel unto you with the Holy Ghost sent down from heaven, which things the angels desire to look into. Man, you got angels saying, hey, now what's going on? What's going on? If the prophets thought it was something great and they wanted to find out about it, and you even have the angels saying, hey, what's all this going on? It must be something great. Remember the rejoicing in the presence of the angels over one sinner that turns from sin? Who's rejoicing in the presence of the angels? God is. The angels want to know. What gets God so excited? When somebody gets born again.
Amen.
When somebody believes in him. When somebody trusts in him. Let's keep going. Look at verse 13. Wherefore, gird up the loins of your mind. Man, that's a kind of a strange statement, isn't it? It means you get your thinking right. You need to put on your thinking cap. You need to be sober and hope to the end for the grace that is to be brought unto you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Wait a minute. When are we supposed to have hope? Right now. But when does that hope become sight? At the revelation of Jesus Christ. Future. So everything that's happening in our life now, because we believe what's in the past, you've got to accept what's in the past. So if God said it, and He said, hey, this is how you're supposed to live your life, and we live our present life by what He's shown us in the past, whether it be good or bad, whether you see somebody, oh, you shouldn't do that, doesn't work out for them, or oh, this is good. So have that in your life, and then that affects your future. It affects your future. And as you read through this book of 1 Peter, you're going to see that more and more. Let's keep going here. Look at verse 15. But as He which hath called you is holy, so be ye holy in all manner of conversation. Now, would that be past, present, or future applied to us? When are we supposed to be holy? Well, there was a time I walked with God. Now, there needs to be a time you're walking with God. How about now? Because it is written, be ye holy, for I am holy. And if ye call on the Father, who without respect of persons judgeth according to every man's work. See, there's some commas there. And if ye call on the Father, pass the time of your sojourning here in fear. That fear is not where you're afraid. That fear is reverence. Because you've called on the name of the Father, you're supposed to live a different life. What He's done for you in the past should affect your present. You say that you believe in God, you say that you've called upon the Lord Jesus Christ, then you ought to control yourself. You ought to demonstrate some self-control. And because of that, that's going to affect your future. Okay? Because there's a judgment seat of Christ coming where you're going to give an account for what you've done in this body, present, whether it be good or bad. Oh my, how you live today does matter. Does matter. Now, let's keep going. Verse 17, or verse 18. For as much as ye know that ye were not redeemed with corruptible things as silver and gold from your vain conversation, received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot, who verily was foreordained before the foundation of the world. Oh, that was past, wasn't it? So what He's done in the past, He's recorded for us in His Word so that we can live our present lives by those truths so that our future can be affected for the good. All right? Who verily was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you, who by Him do believe in God that raised Him up from the dead and gave Him glory, that your faith and hope might be in God. Where is your faith and hope? If your faith and hope is in God, then you're going to live a different life because of it. Okay? We're having youth conference this week, and I have the faith and hope that if these young people listen to the preaching and open their hearts up to the preaching, then they'll be changed. They'll make decisions at youth conference this year that will affect them for the rest of their life. Or they'll come, they'll not pay attention, they don't want the things of God, and they'll turn from the things of God, and their future will be affected. How? Good or bad? Good or bad? I'd rather take a chance on it being good and just decide to live for God. Does that make sense?
Yes, sir.
Does that make sense? Now let's keep going. Look in verse 22. Seeing ye have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit unto unfeigned love of the brethren, see that ye love one another with a pure heart fervently. See, you've purified your souls because you believe the truth, and that's supposed to affect the way that you live even towards others.
Amen.
Oh my, verse 23. Being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the Word of God. Hey, when was the Word of God given? It endureth forever.
Yes.
What God said in the past, He's not changed His mind today, and it will affect your future.
Amen.
But only how you let it affect your future now.
That's good. Yeah.
Jesus Christ died on the cross. His blood was given as the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. But you'll have a whole lot of people that will drop off into hell because they rejected Jesus.
Yeah.
It's not because He doesn't love them. It's because they wouldn't accept Him. Being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the Word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. For all flesh is as grass, and all the glory of man as the flower of grass. The grass withereth, and the flower thereof falleth away. But the Word of the Lord endureth forever. And this is the Word which by the gospel is preached unto you. See, the gospel was put down in print many, many, many years ago. And now we have it right here today, and it's just as effective today in 2020 as what it was in the year 100 AD. Just as effective. Just as effective as when maybe Paul or Peter or John would have preached it, when they wrote it down, when the Holy Ghost moved them as the holy men of God were. It's just as powerful then, just as powerful today, and it'll affect you. How much effect does it have on you? See, now here's where it comes to the place, and you know, look in chapter 2. Wherefore, laying aside all malice and all guile and hypocrisies and envies and all evil speakings. Wherefore, because the gospel was preached unto you, because you're born again, right? You're born again, right? Amen. So you're supposed to lay all that stuff aside. Look in verse 2. As newborn babes, desire the sincere milk of the word that ye may grow thereby. The Bible's going to help you to grow. What the Word of God has been written down in the past will help you to grow to be the person that you're supposed to be. Or, if you don't accept what the past is, what God's given us in the past, the Bible's not changing. It's not changing.
Right.
But if you don't accept what was in the past, that's going to affect your present, and it's going to work into your future.
Yeah.
How's your future going to turn out? Seeing so much in today, we've got this jaded idea that God's supposed to just take care of everything for us. That there should be no suffering. Oh, we ain't even got to all the references to suffering. Let's see. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 references to Christian suffering in this short book of 5 chapters. See, if all persecution ever hit, I bet the churches would be cleaned out. You got so much in Christianity today, and here's what everybody always talks about. Bear with me as I make this statement, because I'm trying to teach you something here, okay? Because we're affected by it. Remember, we are in a building that's not prepared for no electricity. The design of this building goes against where we live. This thing ought to have lots of windows where we could open them up and get a breeze to blow through. We could have church at 7 a.m. in the morning if it meant 63 degrees or 103 degrees.
Right.
I'd get up and come to church early.
Yeah.
Come on.
Yes,
right? Yeah. And maybe come late in the evening when it's cooled down instead of right in the hot of the day.
Right.
See, we've lost some of the wisdom that people had in the past. And that's affected us. And see what you hear. Everything's about God is love. God is love. And He is, okay? And how many passages of Scripture says that specifically, that God is love? You ask somebody about that. Everybody always talks about the love of God, the love of God. And, oh, we're just supposed to love everybody. See, be careful when you start loving everybody. Do you love them or do you love their sin? You've always heard the statement, God hates the sin but loves the sinner. Yeah, but the sinner needs to get their life right.
Yep.
They're not supposed to continue on in that.
Amen. Right.
Judgment's coming. And He'll start judging now.
Yeah.
Okay? But we get all this stuff. God is love. And see, it's the same way that we've got a building that doesn't have windows that we can open up. We as Christians have fallen into that. Oh, there shouldn't be any suffering because God is love. And if God's so loving, why is He letting all this COVID-19 go on? Why is He letting all the... why did George Floyd die? God loves everybody. God didn't kill him.
Right.
A wicked person killed him.
Yeah.
And God's not okay with that.
Right.
But Jesus Christ died on the cross so that George Floyd and also that officer could have their sins forgiven and go to heaven. Oh, no, can't do that. Oh, don't you be self-righteous. God's not willing that any should perish.
Right.
See, there's where we get real subjective. And you get people all uppity about who God can forgive and who God can't. Oh, and He can forgive me, but oh, He couldn't forgive somebody that bad. When I say me, no, I know how bad I was. I know how bad I was. I'm not looking at anybody else. If He can save me, He can save anybody.
Yeah.
You understand that? But see, we've got this, and it's 1 John 4:18, where it says God is love. You're close there. Turn with me. 1 John 4:18. And take it in context. No, 4:8, excuse me. Now look at the last part of the verse, God is love. The only place in Scripture where it shows up there. God is love. But look at the first part of the verse. He that loveth not knoweth not God. Oh my. For God is love. Well, that doesn't go in with mainstream Christianity, does it?
It doesn't. Yes, sir.
Okay. You want another illustration of it? Because everybody tries to say that, oh, Jesus, he just loves everybody and he's willing to put up with everybody. Oh, no, he's not. Sorry, that's not God in the Bible. He does love everybody. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Jesus Christ died on the cross and proved his love for everybody, no matter what they've done. But you can't take what he has, what he's given you. Grace is not to be used as an excuse to sin. Grace is the power to live against sin.
Amen.
To live without sin. I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me. Or I can get away with everything through Christ which strengthens me. Doesn't make sense, does it? But you can live a holy life. Be ye holy, for I'm holy. Didn't we read that? Exactly. Exactly. So now we come back to this thought. God is love. Yeah, exactly. He is love. But I want you, here we're going to read a passage of Scripture. We're going to read 6 verses. And I want you to keep count of every time, specifically, God is love is mentioned. And then keep specifically how many times ungodly is mentioned. Okay? So it's pretty simple. It's an easy test. All you got to do is follow along. You got fingers. You got enough fingers to complete the test. I took it this morning. I'm pretty sure I passed it, okay? Are you ready? Now, let's see. The book of Psalms, what's that all about? That's like that's the Bible's praise and worship music.
Yeah.
I don't really like seeing it that way, because praise and worship music is all, oh, God's love, and everything's about, you know, being happy, and God's doing this, and oh, and they get all caught up in that. But boy, if you cut the amplifiers off, if you took away the microphones, oh, they just wouldn't be able to sing as well. That's all your Christianity is a Sunday morning concert. You don't have much Christianity.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah.
Where's the suffering at?
Yeah.
Make me listen to contemporary Christian music. That's suffering. Okay. Because it says absolutely nothing about the Jesus of the Bible that went to the cross and paid for my sins so that I could escape hell. And now I'm supposed to live for him, and I can't live however I want to.
Right.
In the news in the past couple weeks, you had where one of these Christian singers or whatever, you know, and he's given up on God. He doesn't believe anymore. Well, let me tell you something. God still believes in you, sir, but you never believed in him. Because you believe in him, you ain't walking away from him. You might not walk the righteous life. You might not be always holy, but you ain't going to walk away from him. Now, are you ready for the test? So, you're counting the words love and the words ungodly. You figure out whichever hand you want to use, okay? All right? You're like, well, Pastor, where's that? Let's go to the book of Psalms. And let's go to Psalm 1. Remember all the Psalms? We're supposed to be singing those, you know. That's music. It's songs there. They're there. And so, we want to see this, what God's teaching us in the Bible. Remember what he's put in the past affects our present, okay? And then that affects our future. So let's get some wisdom here, okay? So you're looking for love and you're looking for ungodly. Is everybody there?
Yeah.
You just count quietly as you go through. Move your fingers there for whichever one. And you follow along as I read. Psalm 1 in verse 1. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. The ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind driveth away. Therefore the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. How many times did love show up? How many times did ungodly show up? So the first chapter of the book of Psalms, about songs that we're supposed to be singing, God's warning about the ungodly.
Yeah, that's right.
He's not saying anything about God is love, God is love. God is love, and He does love us. He showed His love. He died on the cross. But He doesn't want us to be affected by the ungodly and the sinners and the scornful. Why? Because if you allow your present life today to be affected by ungodliness and sin and scornfulness towards the things of God, you're not going to have a happy future.
Right.
It's going to affect the way that you live your life.
Yeah.
Now, what are we supposed to delight in? What's it say? Look in verse 2. But His delight is in the law of the Lord.
Right.
Oh, wow. Oh, there's all the rules. There's all the rules. And people get all these love of God people, get all kinds of bent out of shape because God's got rules.
Yeah.
I'm glad God's got rules. Why? Because His rules keep me safe. Okay? His rules keep me on the straight and narrow. His rules keep me out of trouble.
Yeah.
And if I'll just follow His rules, what's going to happen? Well, let's see. I'll be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. Yeah, but you get off that path. You get away from the rules that God's given you. You become an ungodly person. The ungodly are not sober, like the chaff which the wind driveth away. Poof, they're gone. Poof, gone. See, in America today, and the world's been affected by American Christianity, it's all about the love of God, the love of God, love of God. Love of God is, don't do that. For those that are parents, because you love your children, you do what? Hey, don't do that.
That's right.
Don't you do that. You might even apply pressure to a hearing device on your child. Get their attention. No, don't do that. Right? You're there. Let's go to Proverbs 31. Proverbs 21, excuse me. Proverbs 21. Proverbs 21. We looked at this verse, I believe it was last week. Proverbs 21, look in verse 31. See, what your faith today is because of what you believe God wrote in the past, and that's going to affect your future. If God said it, that settles it. And if I'm going to live by it, it's going to affect my future. Look at this. Very simple here. Remember, past, present, and future. The horse is prepared against the day of battle, but safety is of the Lord. Wait a minute. That's telling us if we're preparing the horse against the day of battle, we're doing that today. Battle's coming up. It's in the future. Okay? When you start getting and seeing suffering is not where you can't come to church because of COVID-19. Suffering is not where, would be they burning you at the stake. Yeah, we'd say that's suffering. Suffering sometimes is when you're going to stand up for righteousness and you're going to tell somebody, hey, you shouldn't live that way. Well, who are you to tell me that? Boy, they get all just self-righteous on you. And then that relationship strained. You let a relationship be strained. You ever had a strained relationship? And where you were the one that did right and they were the one that's wrong? Boy, it just feels like suffering, doesn't it? See, and that's where Christians are supposed to be the salt today. And salt, when it's put into a wound, will help the wound to get better. But it burns. But it burns. You're in Proverbs. Look in chapter 22. Chapter 22. You tell me if this verse, it's what we do today, but it affects in the future, okay? Look in chapter 22. Look in verse 6. Train up a child in the way that he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. Man, training the child up today. What we're putting in to our young people today is going to affect them in the future. Now, what are you putting into them? Junk in, junk out. Okay? You put bad stuff into them, you're going to get bad stuff out of them. So if you're going to train them up in the way that they should go, you need to be putting good stuff into them.
Amen.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay. I thought it was. That's why I said it. Okay. Look in verse 23. Verse 23. Chapter 23. Verse 26. My son, give me thine heart, and let thine eyes observe my ways. So here a child needs to give their parent their heart. You know, A parent should never, and a child should be very, a child that has a parent that's abusive. It's a different story, okay? When you have a parent that's just not perfect, if that child still gives their heart to that parent, because now that I'm a parent, I respect my parents a whole lot more. And man, just talking to my mom recently, we've laughed, you know, and she'll say, yeah, we didn't think you'd turn out the way that you did. Boy, I'm lucky I turned out the way that I did. And I mean, you know, and I ain't preaching, I'm stating some facts here. Okay? I may not have always agreed with my parents, but to a certain degree, my parents, they had my heart. And now as I look back on it, they have more of my heart. Because what I might say is mistakes, they were just doing what they needed to do. And I'm not going to hold them against that, because I know I make mistakes because I'm just doing what I'm supposed to do. If you see something, if my kids see something in me that I'm not doing right, give me your heart. But don't do what I do when you become a parent. See, if you've given me your heart, I still love you, Dad, but I'm not going to do that. Come on, learn from someone else's mistakes. Teenagers, don't be critical of your parents, but learn from their mistakes. Okay?
Yeah.
Look at those around you. Look at the other people in the church. What mistakes did they make? Okay? And you don't have to go up, what mistakes did you make? You know, and you want to spill their guts. No, don't do that. But you get to know people, and you'll hear things and see things and realize, hey, don't hold it against them. But don't, if you saw it wreck their life, don't let it wreck yours. Does it make sense? See, we could just keep going on here about these things. Let's go back to Psalm 68. You got all these things where people, I just read this morning. Psalm 68. You know, everybody, oh, God is love. God is love. God just loves everybody. Yeah, He does. He does. He gave His Son, and Jesus Christ died on the cross to pay for the sins of the whole world. Okay? But look in Psalm 68. Are you there?
Yeah.
Look in verse 21. But God shall wound the head of His enemies, and the hairy scalp of such a one as goeth on still in his trespasses. Yeah, God is love, but He's going to say no. God is love, and He's going to train you up in the way that you should go. God is love. You'll give Him your heart. You might not understand that everything He's telling you to do. You might not understand it. But it'll work out for good if you'll just allow Him to lead your life.
Yeah.
There's a lot of things in the Bible. Don't understand, don't know why it's there. But God said it, that settled it. I'm just going to follow it. I'm going to let Him guide my life. I'm glad He's guided my life. I'm glad almost 25 years ago, coming up July 14th, it'll be 25 years since I got saved. July 21st, Evelyn and I will celebrate our 20th year of marriage.
Amen.
I read a story yesterday, Charlton Heston. I think he and his wife were married for 65 years. They asked his son, hey, did your parents ever talk about divorce, or did your mom ever talk about divorce? And no, she never talked about divorce, but she mentioned murder a few times. Some of you that are married, you'll get that. 20 years Evelyn and I have been married. Robert's 19. Graduated from high school. Woo. But if I hadn't been living by the principles of the Word of God, have a desire to live for God, we wouldn't have made it 20 years. I wouldn't even be alive, probably. And what would Robert's life be like? I'm not putting him on a pedestal. But he turned out a whole lot better than what I'd ever thought I would have a kid that turned out. And Anna. And Jesse. Do you understand that? God's just told us some things. Be ye holy, for I'm holy. Oh, well, I'm like that. God loves me anyhow. Oh, yeah. God loves me. Here's the other one. You ever heard this one? I hear it. Like, well, God knows my heart. Oh, He does. And the heart's desperately wicked. You be careful how you throw that one around. Oh, God knows my heart. That one scares me.
Yeah.
I always, when I'm confessing sin, God, You know my heart. You know what was there. Oh, Lord, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
But He's given us His Word. Let's do the best that we can to follow it. We're not going to be perfect. There's not a perfect person on the planet anymore, because Jesus went to heaven.
Right.
all of us can be forgiven. But we're going to have to follow what he says, past, present, and future. Because see, the suffering's coming, and we're going to wonder, well, why's all this going on? God's love, and why is he letting all this happen? Well, no, there's suffering for the Christian. We suffer as a Christian. You understand? See, when you start suffering, and it ain't working out to your conception of who God is, then you're going to start giving up on him. I'm not giving up on him because it doesn't get better till after this life.
Amen.
So I want to be found faithful when I die or when he sounds that trumpet and we're taken out of here.
Amen.
I want to be found faithful. How about you? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Spend some time with the Lord in prayer.